My answer maybe let's get started then. So we are welcome with pleasure Kai Chen from University of Illinois. So I won't give you a long introduction, just go ahead and give your talk.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Kai Chen. I'm from University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And it's my pleasure to be here today that I'll talk about some of the research problems I've done in my PhD study. So let's get started. In the first part of this of my talk, I'll talk about iPad, which is a joint solution of flow control and incentive engineering in a multi-hop ad hoc network. First, talk about the motivation, rationale, and detailed protocol design, and different properties and simulation results. And in the second part of this talk, I'll briefly talk about two other things I've done, which one is the location-guided overlay multicast in a multi-hop ad hoc network, and the other is how to do a multimedia streaming over a wireless LAN test bed. And then I'll spend maybe the last 5 minutes talking about some of the future directions I'll be doing. So how much time do I have?
15 an hour.
An hour, okay. So what is an ad hoc network? Just to recap, because I think many people here know the concept of ad hoc network. Ad hoc network is formed by a group of mobile users using peer-to-peer communication. When they are close to each other, can talk to each other. And when they are far away, the packet has to be forwarded by the...
You're supposed to pull it down the road.
Yeah. The packet has to go through the intermediate nodes to reach the destination. And because of the topology of the network is dynamic, and because of the users are mobile, the topology is dynamic. And the concept of mobile network was introduced in the early 1980s for the military situation, and nowadays it has also been used in many, or proposed in many civilian situations, such as to extend the coverage of infrastructure network, or to become a part of the next generation wireless infrastructure. In the public places, users are not cooperative, and so that they may not be willing to forward packets for other people. In this example, Joe wants to talk to his brother using our networking, and the packet has to go through this guy in the middle, and this guy will say, "Why do I want to forward your packet if it consumes my resources?" So that this guy will drop all the packets and Joe cannot talk to his brother. So the point here is that in public places, since the users are selfish, without an incentive mechanism, multi-hop ad hoc networking cannot take place. So incentive engineering in this context is to study how to motivate the users to forward the packets for other people. Now I'll talk a little bit about flow control. Flow control is a basic networking function that decides how fast we send our packet from the sender to the receiver over the network. Sending too fast will overwhelm the network, sending too slowly will underutilize the network. So that flow control has to decide a optimal rate that the user can send. And when they are competing, when there are multiple flows competing for resources, flow control has to decide a certain fairness between the competing flows. And generally, there are two types of flow control, implicit and explicit. In implicit flow control, the sender inputs the congestion state and decides the sending rate by itself. And one example is, of course, the TCP in Internet. In explicit flow control, the router detects the congestion state and informs the sender its sending rate. And one example is AT&T's ADR service. And these are two general types of flow control.
Yeah. So in this case, you don't differentiate between congestion control and flow control?
Actually, yeah, that's a good question. Here, I refer, I say flow control, that means congestion control. So I don't differentiate these two. So you can consider flow control as congestion control in this case. Traditionally, flow control or congestion control and internet engineering are two separate problems. And over the internet, many of the researchers on flow control does not consider incentive issues because they assume the routers are cooperative. However, in a mainnet environment, the routers are no longer cooperative, so that incentive engineering and flow control has to be integrated together. And taking this early example, when Zhou wants to talk to his brother, he has to consider the willingness of this guy to forward his packet. So that flow control must consider the willingness of the intermediate router to forward the packet in this special network.
I missed the point of assuming cooperative routers in the internet. What do you mean?
So that in the internet, when the packet has to go through this router in the middle, the router has to provide this service.
Okay, well, in the internet, the normal mode is TCP, which doesn't require any cooperation, explicit cooperation.
But it doesn't. It requires implicit cooperation, though, so that the routers along the path has to be cooperative. Otherwise, you're not going to send out any packets to the receiver because all the packets have been dropped at the intermediate routers. That's the internet model, is that the routers are cooperative. But here in the mainnet, because everybody owns the router, so that they may not be cooperative, especially because the resources of the router, for example, PDA or cell phone, is very limited.
But then how is incentive engineering, when you say they are separate problems, that basically I would say that there is no incentive engineering in wired internet?
It's not being studied in the traditional internet literature. So this is what the framework, the research framework looks like before I study this problem. There's no collaboration between these two. And here's the framework in my study. This imposes an interesting challenge for me, which is how to harmonize the two and to achieve optimal results on both ends. And this will be the main topic of today's talk, which is the joint solution. So I'll go over the design rationale at a high level here. So one rationale behind our design is the table surface model of cooperation. Sender has to provide certain reward for the router to forward the packet. And by forwarding packets, the router can accumulate digital currency, which will then later pay for its own packet forwarding. We choose the pay-for-service model of cooperation because this is widely applicable to many networking scenarios in ad hoc network, since it does not require the mutual packet forwarding dependency between the sender and the router. And we assume that there's a secure payment accounting system to facilitate the exchange of the funds between the sender and the router. The other rationale is the explicit resource allocation model, where the resource of the router is explicitly allocated by the router itself. The sender may request certain amount of resources from the routers. However, it's the router who decides how much resource that the sender can obtain. And this is because the routers are controlled by the individual users, so that the users will have authority in deciding the resource allocation for the passing flows. And later we'll show that the resource allocation from the routers will provide a congestion signal to the sender for flow control purposes. Feel free to ask questions if you have any. So let's look at the system framework from a high level point of view. Each router functions as an option market in this scheme. Am I blocking? When the sender sends out a packet, it attaches a bit and request for bandwidth in each packet. The packet will go through the routers. At each router, there are multiple competing flows for the resources. And there are multiple routers along the path so that the option markets are connected with each other. when the packet goes through this router, it will carry the resource allocation from this router. And when the packet goes to the receiver will retrieve the final allocation of this from this auction market, and you will send out a feedback packet to the sender to inform its data sending rate. So basically, this is a feedback based flow control framework.
So you'll tell us what the structure of a bid is.
Yeah, in better detail next. But this is the high level overview to give you a big picture.
Are you bid? You bid on what basis? Per packet or
per unit of bandwidth.
So it's for the life of the connection, or for how long time do you get your bid?
The sender can bid anything that it wishes to bid.
But I bid something, I get that resource for how long?
It can be changed instantaneously. There's no holding of the resource for certain amount of period.
So it's basically per packet, or?
The signaling is per packet. So that if something changes in the middle, for example, if there's a new flow joining a router, then the resource allocation may be changed, and then this resource allocation result will be feedback to the sender.
From router or from receiver?
It will go through the router first. And then it will go to the receiver, and then the receiver will inform the sender.
Okay.
So within a long trip time of delay, then you should be able to get the updated on the source allocation information.
So you've analyzed the overhead which your scheme brings?
Yeah, I'll talk about overhead later. It has some overhead, it has some advantages and disadvantages.
So the sender pays?
The sender pays.
And the feedback packet, the receiver tells him something, like how fast to send?
In a sending rate.
Okay. So what does the receiver learn? Like, does the successive router auction decisions are all forwarded to the receiver?
Yeah, it actually is part of the packet. Okay. So I put the result in a packet header, a special packet header. So that this is a sort of an event signaling protocol.
Okay.
Yes.
Does the receiver have the phase for the feedback packet?
That's a good question. It has to pay the feedback packet. Although the feedback flow, the feedback packet may be very small, so that the bandwidth of the feedback flow is small anyway. And the second, the feedback packet doesn't have to be very frequent. If the resource allocation doesn't change, you can wait maybe once in a while to send a feedback packet. Unlike TCP, if you control the window based AIMD congestion control, then you have to feedback every one or two packets. But here you don't have to give feedback for every packet.
So the feedback path should be the same as the forwarding path, right?
It could be different.
It could be different. It means that you need to have another bid and request for your feedback part. Before you have that, how can you send them back? How can you send the feedback back to the sender?
First of all, the feedback flow is very the bandwidth is small. It carries only the signal information.
So it's not piggyback from something.
It's not piggyback on something. Although if you have a network data flow, you could piggyback. That's between you and the sender and receiver. And the sender and receiver should be thought of as two collaborative entities, because you are sending something to the receiver who you know.
So basically, you assume because the feedback package is so small that all routers or all users in the network will offer the free service.
That's one option though.
Okay.
But there's another option which you have to pay, but you just pay a little bit.
Thank you.
But that's one option. before going into details of the auction market, I'll give you some definitions that will later use in the presentation. The term utility is user's valuation for certain goods, which is how much the good is worth to the user. And payoff is the users will pay the less the price to pay. That's the payoff. And option is nothing new, it's just a well-known mechanism to allocate unlimited resources to a group of competing bidders in economic sense. And the user's bidding price in the option market is called a bid. Here, user can bid higher or lower than the utility for the good, depends on user's bidding strategy. And there's a bidding strategy called true for bidding, which means that the user always bids the true utility for the good. I'll take a very simple example. If a book is worth it's worth $10 for the user and the user pays $10 for the book, that's called true for bidding. Next, I will introduce a special auction format called decree auction, which is the basis for our scheme. In decree auction, the highest bidder wins auction but only pays the price of the second highest bid. And this is sometimes called the second price auction. For example, if there are six bidders bidding for a book, and the bids are 10, 9, 7, 4, and so on, the highest bidder, the $10 bidder, will win the auction, will get the book, but only pays the price of the second highest bid, which is $9. And a remarkable property of the bigger auction is that true for bidding always leads to higher payoff for a user, and this has been proved in a classical example of a bigger auction in a paper in 1961. Now I'm going to details of the bidder request in the auction market. The user is concerned about how much data can get through the network so that she submits a bid and request for bandwidth, because this is what is concerned most to the user. However, the router has to convert this bid and request for bandwidth into a bid and request for the proportion of the channel time that it has to provide to satisfy this request. And the reason that has to convert into the channel time proportion is that the channel time measures real resources that the browser has to provide to satisfy user's request. And I'll show how this conversion is done using the following example. The sender bids $10 per second per unit of bandwidth, and this is the user's bid. And the user requesting 400 units of bandwidth. And let's assume that the outgoing link bandwidth, achievable bandwidth is 800 bits per second. So equivalently, the user is willing to pay $8,000 per second to occupy 50% of the channel. That means it's asking the router to provide to be active 50% of the time to transport the traffic for this purpose, and then it's the sender is willing to pay $8,000 per second for this service. And how do I get this one, which is called the modified bit? It's just simply the bit for bandwidth times the bit for bandwidth times the bandwidth, which is the modified bit for the proportion for a unit of channel time. And likewise, the request for the bandwidth has to be converted into the request for channel time using this little formula. And this, when there are multiple flows, the modified bit actually indicates the competitiveness of the bit in this auction market for a router. I will show an example of multiple bidders in the auction market in this table. There are six bidders, and this is the user's bid for bandwidth, and this is user's request for bandwidth, and this is the outgoing link bandwidth. At the router has to convert the bid and request for bandwidth into a bid and request for channel time. And since the modified bid measures the competitiveness of the flows in the auction market, the router has to sort this modified bit in a descending order. In this table, each flow is indicated using a different color so that after the sorting, the order of the flows has changed. According to the multiple unit bakery auction, the highest bidder will win the auction. So that, for example, this vote, the first vote is asking for 50% of the channel time. It's allocated 50% of channel time because it's the highest bidder. This vote is asking for 40%, and then you can get 40%.
But he doesn't say I want 40%. He just says something over here on the left, right?
Yes.
He says I want 2 is just the number of his flow. Like for the sake of the second row, like start way over on the left. So 2 is just.
This is the bandwidth, the bid for bandwidth.
That's his bid for bandwidth.
Uh huh.
Okay. And then he requires 50 bits per second, or
he requires 50. This is a 50 bits per second, yeah. This is the measurement of the bandwidth.
Okay, and then it says the bandwidth, the next column is, what's the next column?
This is outgoing links bandwidth, because each flow may have a different destination from each router. A flow can go to different destinations. So that between the router and the next hop, each link, or you can consider this as a channel, may have different.
So that user, he wants to go on an outgoing link that has bandwidth 200, right?
Yeah. And then from here, you can convert it into a modified bit, which indicates how much the flow is going to pay per unit of channel for the router, because that's really the effort that the router has to provide to satisfy this request.
Oh, right. What does this mean? So 500 and 200, that means these are two different links. So they are not competing with each other, and they are along different links.
Although the router only has one air interface.
Oh.
So that you still are competing for resources.
Okay.
For example, power in this case.
So 50 is the requirement, and 200 is the available bandwidth
Of that link.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, yes.
So 400 comes from, I know it was on the previous slide, but it's sort of hard to. So the number 420, so tell us how you get the numbers 400 and 25.
400 is simply this 2 times 200.
Okay.
And that's the measurement of how much you want to pay per second to occupy 1% of the channel.
Okay, and
this is only
50 divided by 200.
Yeah, this is measured what request, which is what do you require the router to be active in transmitting your packets to the next hop in the scheme.
Okay.
So this is the request and converted request and the bit in this auction market. And according to the multiple unit bakery auction, the higher bidders will win the auction. And then this one will only be allocated 10% because the other 90% has been occupied by the other two folks who are the higher bidders.
I'm not sure where this now conversion from. I mean, where is this battery usage or something taken into account? They say because they compete because they use still some resources. So where is that expressed in the formulas?
I look at this from a high level point of view, so that I do not model the energy consumption explicitly. I look at this router from point of view of how much time that it has to be active in providing the service.
Sorry.
The time of. And also according to the multi-unit bakery auction, the charge for each pro should be the opportunity cost of losing certain amount of allocation for the losing flow. For example, the opportunity cost of losing 10% of the channel time should be 10% times this modified bit, which is 2400. And this is what the cost of losing certain amount of resources to the losers. According to the multi-unit regression, the charge for each flow is the opportunity cost for the losing flow, and let's look at the example of the first flow. Out of the winning 50% of allocation, 10% comes from the third flow, 10% comes the fourth flow, 20% comes from the fifth flow. And although the sixth flow has lost 25%, only 10% will be counted because 50% has been maxed out. So that the flow charge for this, for winning, for the first flow winning portion allocation should be the sum of the opportunity cost to the losing flow up here. And then you can sum this up, and this will be the charge for the first flow. Likewise, you can compute the charge for the second flow using the same principle and so on. And this is according to the multi-unit version of regular auction.
Okay.
Yeah.
Actually, my question is related to your prior explanation. Mm-hmm. I'm a bit confused about the bit and the request there. I mean, the units, what does it mean? I mean, dollars per second per bandwidth? And you request for bandwidth, but you bit for, I mean, how can you relate the units for bit to
this one?
Yeah.
This one, the unit is how much do I want to pay per unit of time?
Okay.
In order to get a unit of bandwidth, so that if I'm getting transmitting a flow of audio voice,
okay,
and maybe I need certain amount of bandwidth, X unit of bandwidth.
Okay.
And then I'm willing to pay a certain amount of money for this to transfer this amount of bandwidth for the flow. So this is from the user's perspective, because the user is concerned about how much bandwidth that the user can push.
But the user does not tell for how long he wants to reserve.
No, although the user may end the session anytime, mm-hmm, but that when the session is ongoing, then the user has to bid in order to keep himself or herself in the business.
You know, if you were selling services, you often give sort of good customers a discount.
Uh-huh.
Somebody who says, I'll be your customer for a year at a nice steady rate,
yeah,
and say, well, I'll give you a better price, right?
Yeah.
Because you're going to be faithful, right, loyal. And it seems like in this kind of auction, if you're somebody who says, I'll pay a lot of money, but I just want the service for a microsecond, right, and then I'll go away, you're going to always give the service to this person who is maybe very disruptive, but in total doesn't really, he's not a very, a customer who
revenue generates.
Who generates a lot of revenue. He just gives you a very high price for a short instance.
Yeah, I think there are two issues to this model. One is that when you want to identify a loyal customer, you have to know this person over time. But in ad hoc network, you can encounter many different people at different places, so that it will be hard to encounter the same set of customers over time. And the second is that from the economic point of view, although just a disruptor who just bid very high for a very short period of time, from the doctor's point of view, it's still beneficial to serve this guy. Because after that, you can continue to serve your regular customer. But in order to, from the browser's point of view, is I can obtain more.
Well, so when you serve like somebody like that, like what happens to these people who didn't get their bids, who didn't get any?
Okay, I'll explain this later in the example. I'll give a number of examples too.
I want to understand something else also. So you're saying that every router has a single network card. It's not like, I mean, many of these devices nowadays come with Bluetooth and with 802.11. So you say each one has only one card.
In the current model, I only consider one interface. But I mean, it's possible to extend it into to accommodate multiple interfaces.
So even if you have one interface, the wireless channel has to be shared among nearby routers due to MAC layer contention.
Right.
So you don't know what fraction of time is available to your output port. So how do you account for that?
That's taken into account in this actual bandwidth of the link. For example, if there's a high contention at the MAC layer, it may take longer for me to just yield to the traffic in the channel, so that the bandwidth will be lower.
So you're saying that you have an estimator in
This is measure. This is a measure bandwidth using the past history, using a short period of past history, so that I know I can estimate how much bandwidth I can push to my next neighbor.
In this example, what is that number?
This column is the estimated bandwidth.
So that's not transmission rate, like modulation rate of the stars.
Because you have to consider the contention from the neighbors, maybe not even.
How do you estimate that?
I use the history of the packet to measure, so that it takes into account the contention and interference and signal fading and so on.
Modulation.
Yeah, it's more at the higher level point of view. I do not model the MAC layer explicitly, but that is kept into account of the MAC layer scenario.
Do you use the exponentially moving average?
I use the average. Using a 2 second average of the past history, although exponential, that's fine. Exponential average is fine. And we have tested this system using NS2 simulation. They're not 100% accurate, but they are reasonably accurate. And there's another important concept here in the auction market is the maximum allocation for flow. The maximum allocation is the maximum allocation that you can attend when you increase a request. For example, for the first flow, because it's the highest bidder, so that the maximum that it can get is 100% of the channel. For the second flow, because it's the second highest bidder, so it can only obtain 6% because the other 50% has been occupied by the higher bidder. And for the first flow, only 10% will be allowed because the other 90% has been occupied by the higher bidder. And this will serve as a congestion signal to the flow. Yes.
I just want to understand, so your bid depends only on the application.
Depends on the application.
It doesn't depend on the request. Is that right? For
different? Although the application wants to bid, maybe it has to consider how much budget they have, so that it also has to consider the request in some way. But that's totally up to the application or to the user.
Is your bid the slope of the utility function?
I'm sorry?
Is the bid just the slope of your utility function?
Yes.
So I guess it's just a general question. I mean, usually the utility function is curved, right? So here we're running into the same problem.
Yeah, I think here the utility function indeed is a slope, it's a linear curve. And I think it's up to the application to divide maybe a flow into different subflows so that they can attach different importance to different subflows so that you can differentiate different traffic depending on the importance, and then can submit a different bit for the different flows.
So in this example, green and yellow, the first two, get exactly what they wanted. Like they get a certain rate, a certain fraction of the time, 50% and 40%.
Right.
But blue, he only gets 10% of the time of the router, but he wanted 20.
Yeah.
So, but somehow you still charge him the same per bit as if you gave him 20, or does he pay? I guess somehow, what does he pay?
He will this flow, if it only wins 10%, then only the forward dip traffic will be charged.
Right, but somehow the, like, I would think if somebody says, oh, I want a certain rate, and I'll pay this price per bit, and somebody then gives you a lower rate, maybe you aren't willing to pay the same amount per bit.
But if you don't want to pay the same amount of money for this resource, then somebody else will be willing to pay. So there is a contention between this flow. For the third flow, although the third flow is asking 20%, only allocate 10%,
right.
Only 10% will be charged.
Right. But I'm just saying, usually, if, like, sometimes people don't, then, you know, it's like, I'll pay a certain price for a whole loaf of bread, but I won't pay half the price for half a loaf if I need a whole loaf.
So it's either 0 or 1, is that correct?
But in your model, it's you pay half a loaf. Half a loaf.
Yeah, you pay whatever you are being allocated to.
Yeah.
And one assumption about the application is that it's more of elastic traffic flow. For example, FTP, so you can utilize whatever you are being allocated to.
Okay.
Have 10% of the rainbow limit because
we can choose the
several charges that you have. Okay. Have you, could you just explain a little bit how you distribute them?
Okay.
I see that you have a total of 60%, but you choose them like
the...
So the charge?
Yeah.
You're asking how
to
compute the price for the
flow? Yeah, how you distribute
the price. According to the multi-unit regression, the charge for the winning flow is the opportunity cost of the losing flow. So that the cost of winning 50% of the time of the channel is 10% comes from the third flow. So the cost for this flow is 10% times this modified bit. 10% comes from the next flow, so that the charge will be 10% times its modified bit, and so on until its resource allocation has been maxed out.
So, in the end of the network, a router at the same time could also be a sender or receiver.
Mm-hmm.
So you should also consider time of the by itself.
You could, although I mix the traffic together, and the reason is if somebody else is offered more digital money to occupy your channel than the importance of your own task, then you should be able to, you should serve the other folks instead of your own traffic in order to earn more digital currency, and because this will be valuable to you for later use.
Does the bit from this router carry over to the next router?
Yes.
So your timeline is usually being per hop.
Per hop.
And what if I have an alternate?
What if you have?
So let's say I have three different paths for this creation. How do I distinguish between them?
I can see that you have a single path from the sender to receiver at this moment.
Oh, so it's just...
Although if you change the path, then you have to bid for the resources along the different paths.
Sure.
But if you have, for example, multiple paths as you suggested, then possibly you can monitor this path and then choose the lower cost path to transfer your packets. I'll show you an example of how this is how the flow will go through multiple auction markets. It carries the maximum request for bandwidth and the current sending rate of the flow in each data packet. So, for example, in the first auction market, the maximum allocation for this flow is 50% of the channel, which is equivalent to 625 of units of bandwidth. So that this packet will not be limited by the allocation at the first auction market. It will go to the second auction market, and here we have only 400. The allocation is only 400 units of bandwidth. So that this RR, which is the maximum request, and the CR, which is the current request, has to be reduced to reflect this bottleneck. And again, it will go to the next auction market until it reaches the destination. And the receiver will then send out a feeder packet to the sender to inform it the bottleneck allocation, which is 400. In the next round, the sender will start to use 400 at its current sending rate, but it still keeps the maximum request at 500 because it will try to see if the market condition can improve in the future and they can obtain more bandwidth. After the second round, the allocation is still 400 so that it reaches a stable state. Let's look at what happens when multiple flows going to multiple auction markets. The first flow goes from R1 to R4, bids for 1. The second flow goes from R1 to R3, bids for 2. And the third flow goes from here to R4, bids for 3. And that's a
so again, I mean, this is a bid for future packets, or
not. What do you mean by future packets?
I mean, not the one which is carrying this request.
This is part of the header of the packet.
Okay, but
so that
I mean, so this kind what you now get from, let's say, router 2,
mm-hmm.
is what presumably your following subsequent packets will have that kind of time sharing on the router 2, yeah. Or,
yeah, if I understand your question correctly, yes.
So every subsequent packet also carries some sort of
bits and requests, so that the market can be disturbed at any time. If a newcomer joins in, or sometimes they may change the request or the bits.
So the granularity of this bidding is the packet.
It's at the time granularity is at the packet level.
Yeah.
So that you can change your request very instantaneously in the next packet if you want.
When do you get charged?
When a router forwards the packet, it has to keep a receipt of sending out the packet, and then you will later on, you will report to a central credit clearance service just to exchange the funds between the different accounts, which represents the senders or the routers. This is what happens at each router. So in the first router, there are two bidders, and the first number indicates the current sending rate of each flow, and the second number indicates the maximum request. And again, in the second router, there are three bidders, and in the third router, there are two bidders. At the end of this allocation, F1, the first flow is allowed to send out 0 bandwidth, the second is allowed to send out 100, and the third flow is allowed to send out 500. And what do I mean here? That I can only be allowed to send out a 0 packet, that means it has lost option. And it has to enter a probing state where it can only send out packets very slowly just to try to probe the market condition to see if it can be improved in the future.
One more question. So, does it vary on packet basis? Because let's say one packet, you send it and right away it went through. The other packet got lost a couple, you had to resend it 3 or 4 times. But do you charge differently for each one of them?
What I mean by bidding at packet level is that for each packet you can attach a different bit if you want to change some bit.
Then it doesn't matter how many times you have to retransmit it.
That you can make such a decision at the application level, it doesn't matter. For example, if you are trying to send out an email which is not very important, But over the time, this email will become more and more important because you are approaching your deadline. So that the utility for sending out the traffic will become larger when it approaches the deadline. And that's the strategy of the application.
How does the first packet reach the first router?
Is it four lanes?
Can you send a ring?
Do you have a guaranteed minimum rate to send? I mean, how do you get your, suppose that your congested router, how will my traffic ever reach that?
Each flow should be able to guarantee just a very, very small, like I said, a probing, at least a probing rate of transmission, so that if some place, if some route is congested, then the congestion state can still go through to the next routers until you reach the destination, so that you can report to the sender to just slow down.
Yeah, but in your system, you drop some to zero, so...
It allows to send out zero, but it still allows to send out packets using a very slow probing rate. And that is allowed by the router.
So I'm still having, I understand this model, it has been used for broadband ISDN in the past. You might have read some papers.
Yes.
It seems like ATM type of model when in ad hoc routing, there's no fixed path and there's no concept of a flow. I'm sort of looking for how it works in on-demand routing where there's no concept of bandwidth.
When a flow goes through a path, it will be along this path, but if the path is changed to a different path, then the first packet traveling through this new path will carry a new resource allocation along this new path. So that it actually adapts nicely to the ad hoc network environment because if this is the explicit flow control solution. So that the packet actually solves the congestion state of the network without, for example, without trying to increase the rate and get lost until you can cut back your rate, such as in TCP. So that actually on-demand routing is not a problem of applying the ATM type of flow control in this network, because when you change your route, you get a new resource allocation immediately after one round trip time.
But the problem is, I pay $10 for, example, 100 meters per second. I pay it, and then later on, you somewhere on the in the past, somewhere got congested, and then you cannot finish it our contract. So how can I pay the money I pay for you?
And this situation should happen only rarely, because what you are sending is actually the bottleneck bandwidth. You are not allowed to send out more than the bottleneck bandwidth. So that whenever you send out, you should be able to get through because you are sending at the bottleneck rate.
But it is dynamic changed because it is wireless.
It's wireless. It is wireless. And what I'm saying is that this congestion signal should be accurate enough for the next launch time. Then if some place is congested, then the congestion state will be returned to the sender, okay. waiting wrong one round trip time, and then you can correct your sending rate whatever that you want.
So the sender needs to bid again.
It needs to bid again, or it just needs to send out less traffic, depending on how much bandwidth you are getting at this moment.
Question. If everybody is bidding at the same price, is it the same as the lesbian fairness problem?
Although then everybody will be bidding the same.
So sometimes it is very hard to classify this kind of bidding systems because usually nobody don't know what their application is behaving in the lower layer.
Although the utility does not depend only on the network, it depends on what's important to you. So that actually it's a very subjective measurement. and then everybody should have a different measurement for their utility. Although, like you said, in a very rare cases, everybody will be building the same. Then this scheme will just break it using a random, changing to just a random allocation.
Because, you know, I think that, you know, low bound should be kind of, you know, that's the fairness problem in wireless network.
In one network, next thing, yeah.
And so that even though everybody's being.
I get what you're saying. Yes.
You should provide some kind of, you should remove this kind of randomness from your scheme.
Okay, maybe I'll answer your question offline. But I think at this moment, I think you're still competing in the market. What you are doing is that everybody is bidding the same, so that it doesn't matter that which flow that the router will allocate resource to.
But if everybody is bidding the same, the system should provide kind of fair bandwidth, right? So kind of fairly.
This is after the allocation after the first round, and this is the allocation after the second round, and this is the resource allocation for the three floors after it has stabilized. And here the second link is the bottleneck link because its bandwidth has been fully utilized.
Yeah. When is the sender charged for his flow? When the receiver finally gets the packet, or when the first router forwards the packet?
The receiver will get the packet when the packet goes through all the routers.
When is the sender charged for his flow?
Okay, yeah. At each router, the router has to set the receipt for sending out a packet. For example, by keeping the packet header for each packet, they have forwarded to the next router.
And so you don't care whether it successfully reached the destination. You just say, I forwarded it. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. Okay. Although the chance of the first router for the packet, but later on you will get dropped is actually fairly small because what the sender is sending is according to the bottleneck bandwidth. So that it doesn't actually.
Okay, so that can happen only first time later.
After the launching time, you can correct the sending rate.
But your DDN scheme is at the level of packet generation, right? The generality level is per packet. So what happens if the bid is lost at the router R3?
You mean the bid is lost?
It is not allocated any portion of the bandwidth by router R3, so, but it has already been forwarded by R1 and R2. So in that case, will the sender be charged for the packets because the receiver is not receiving the packets?
But after the next round, then the sender should be able to know that I have lost the option in the third router, so that I shouldn't send out the flow as quickly as the first two routers allow the flow to send out. So that this is a fee that after a round trip time, that the sender should know how much data.
The bandwidth is available, but he has to increase his bid. So how can you infer that only bandwidth is not available? Probably some other competing clause would have bid. Yeah, in here, so they lost the bid. You lost the auction. Does that answer the question? You have another question. You know, the sender did not check out the rocket three.
Right, the sender only talk to R1 and R1 make decision based on his information. And then after pick up the rocket 2 and rocket 2 pick up rocket 3 based on his information. So in after one move, the sender knows his package got lost at rocket 3. But the sender still can do nothing. Do you mean the sender will say something? Okay, please avoid rocket 3. Is it correct?
You cannot do this because you just simply lost option. The only thing they can do is increase your bid, just to increase your competitiveness in the option market. Because from this router's point of view, it will be more beneficial or profitable to serve the other folks. The only way you can do is to improve.
So when you go through a multi-hop route, the actual charge the sender pays is the sum of, like say over two hops, is the sum of the two charges?
Yeah. Now let's look at what happens if something changes. The first change is the bandwidth increase from 600 to 700. So, and who gets the extra bandwidth? The answer is the second flow, because the first flow has been outbidden by the second flow in the second router, according to the auction scheme. And next, look at another change, which is that the first flow exits the network, and this can be caused by one of two reasons. Either this flow has ended, or it has changed its route because of the mobility. Now the bottleneck link becomes the first link, and the first flow can now send out 100 units of bandwidth, and that means the first flow can go out of the province that can resume its normal packet transmission. And these are the conditions after the examples of changes in this network. I think I have to speed up a little bit. This is the signal protocol for the examples that I just described. And the sender sets the maximum request, and the current sending rate and the packet can be reduced by the router and so on. The purpose of the RR is to probe the bottleneck bandwidth from the network, and the purpose of the CR is to carry the bottleneck bandwidth from the bottleneck router to the other routers, so that there's no over reservation along at the non bottleneck routers along the path. And the two purposes for this protocol for incentive engineering, it carries the big request to the auction market, and for flow control, it carries the maximum request and current rate to the routers. And clearly, this is an explicit flow control scheme in the sense that the rate allocation is determined by the routers, not by the chain system. And recall that flow control has two purposes. Has two goals, fairness and efficiency. Yeah. Fairness means that resource allocation has to be fairly allocated, and this is achieved by using a prioritized scheme in the auction market depending on the needs of the users. Efficiency means that the resource of the network has to be utilized as much as possible. And when the bids are competitive, the router will allocate all its resources to the targeting flow, and this will achieve the efficiency goal of the flow control scheme.
Have you also considered the implicit flow control without
that will be difficult to be combined with the incentive mechanism, because in that case then the sender decides the sending rate by itself, it's not the router. But actually the router should have authority in deciding the allocation, because each router is owned by the user, so that each user should have authority in deciding the resource allocation for the flow. This is why implicit flow control cannot be owned. I'm not sure, but it's not very easy to combine implicit flow control with the incentive engineering method. HIPAA extends the single market regulation into a set. Single market regulation only applies to a single market resource allocation. But here we have different routers. We have a connected auction market, so that it can be resolved by dividing the user speed evenly among the routers. And we limit the users to bid the same amount in each router in order to preserve the true for bidding properties of our scheme. And the second difference is that the router measures resource differently than the users, so that the router has to convert the user speed and request from bandwidth into channel time. And then this modified bit will become the real bit in the auction market. This is the properties of our scheme. The first property is that the dominant strategy for a user is truth or bidding. And that means that the user will have the highest payoff when she bids the true utility for bandwidth. And we can prove this by constructing the user payoff function using the modified bit and request at the router, and so that when the user overbids, the result will be either the same as true for bidding, or the user will have negative payout even when she wins. In the underbidding case, the result the result will be either the same as true for bidding, or the user will have zero payoff in this case. In the multi-router scenario, since we limit the user to bid the same amount at each router, so that overbidding and underbidding will lead to lower, will lead to the same or lower payoff for the user, so that the user do not have incentive to overbid or underbid. And this is the first property. And the second property is that the user's payoff is not negative, and this is because the price of pay is always lower than the user's bid, because this is the second price option. And this has been proved in the single market maker option, and we extend this result into our scheme, and we prove it using the modified bids and modified requests. And since the user's payoff is non-negative, the user has incentive to participate in our scheme.
So if I get electrically, you extend it to having these multiple winning bids at one router.
Yeah, and change the bids and request. It's not the original bid anymore, it's the modified bid.
Right.
And then you can still preserve this property as in the single market bidding option scheme. The third property is that the iPads must always lead to the increase in aggregate utility for the users and routers. And this is because when the router forwards a packet, it has to be forwarded at a price lower than, higher than the router's cost, and lower than the user's bid, which is the true utility. So that packet forwarding must always increase the total utility for the sender and the router, for the whole network.
There's some notion in there of some kind of utility over time with that, right? Like, how do you define? Some notion of that. You have to have a new request, or you know, and when you say it must always lead to, it's either you have a static situation, you compare it to something that's not like that, or
I compare forwarding versus not forwarding, so that when an event of forwarding happens, this event must lead to the increase of total utility for the whole network, including the sender and the routers.
So if iPod does not increase the aggregate utility, then forwarding doesn't happen?
Yeah, that means the bid is too low, lower than the cost of the forwarding, so that this won't take place.
But it seems as though you don't have any guarantee that maybe if the auction had some kind of, the routers had some kind of coordination, that there could have been a collection of bids, right, that would be higher total utility than what this particular strategy gives
you. That's assuming that each router is determined to reach a global network goal. Right, is that right?
So you put aggregate utility
on aggregate
the total network goal.
Yeah, even in this distributed environment where each router is individually owned, you can still increase the aggregate utility by folding packets.
Right. So the alternative is we did some global optimization based on willingness to pay, the routes every packet follows,
and
flow constraints, and you could find some prices people would pay.
Optimal result.
And it would maximize total aggregate utility.
Right.
And somehow you do fall short of that.
Yeah, I can only approve that it increased, but I cannot prove that it reached optimal.
Yeah.
And this is, I think, in that the router has to be cooperative in selecting, for example, how to route the packets to different paths in order to reach that goal. But here, it's because each router is just an individual device, so that I do not assume that routers will be cooperative in reaching the system goal, optimal system goal. But I can still prove that it will increase aggregate utility by forwarding.
So are there situations in which forwarding doesn't happen? Like, at some corner of the network, actually, forwarding
doesn't happen? Well, it can be possible if the bids are too low, way too low, that it doesn't make sense for the router to forward the packets. Then I
thought it always makes sense for a router to forward the highest bidder's packet.
But
because if the highest, then
even the highest is falls below than your reserve price.
You could pay the auction as a reserve price?
That's a router's cost. If the bits are way too low, then the router won't even for the packet. Because I mean in an auction market case, then it's better for the router to just not doing anything.
So do you have some physical model for that? This idea of wiring power?
I don't have a physical model for that. It's just something that the user, the router can set maybe to enforce such a policy.
That's
okay.
I think that's
if you have a, well, you can model that using energy and have a very detailed model. But right now I do not have that. Although you can model that into the cost of the router, depending on how much energy you left on the devices, for example, and so on. I'll go over this result very quickly, and this shows that in a single market case, a higher bidder will have a higher priority obtaining the bandwidth, and this is the router's queue length, and that means the router's queue length is small and stable, and that means the red signal is able to guide the flows into efficiently utilizing the router's resources. And this is result in the two market kinetic market case. Again, the higher bidding flow will have priority in obtaining the bandwidth. And this is in a dynamic ad hoc network scenario. Again, the higher bidder will have priority in obtaining the bandwidth. And we have also verified that the router queue in this case is also small and stable. A little summary of IPAS. It's a joint solution of intense engineering and flow control. And we take a mapping of this reduction from economics into ad-hoc networks in computer science. And this mapping is non-trivial in the sense that we have to do the big and request conversion, the multiple routers along the path, and the auction has to be integrated with the flow control solution. And we also manage to maintain several desirable system properties in this network. So in addition to IPAS, I've also researched in other implicit flow control approaches in ad hoc network, including TCP and equation-based approach. And we're also among the first to recognize the advantage of using explicit flow control in this network. Now I will briefly go through the how much time do I have. Maybe
almost out of time, maybe just one view.
Okay, so this is a project that looks how to construct the overlay multicast tree in this network. I do an overlay multicast. And the question is, how can you construct an efficient multicast tree from this for the group of users? And the core idea of this solution is that we use the location of the node as heuristic to construct a tree. Because the network topology is not known. It's dynamic and it's very expensive to learn. So that we use just the location of the nodes as a heuristic to construct the tree. And the rationale is that the longer the geometry distance, on average, will translate into larger number of hops to reach the destination. So that this is why location heuristic is successful. We have proposed three algorithms, including the canary tree, directional tree, and final tree algorithm. And we compare this the proposed algorithm in a dynamic network case. The lowest line, the green one, corresponds to the optimal multicast tree, which is constructing using a standard tree, but with the global network topology. So that this is the optimal result you can obtain from this network, and it will serve as low bound for the other algorithm.
So what's the definition of bandwidth?
The bandwidth is what's the hop count of sending a packet to the multicast group. The number of hops you have to transmit to the rest of the group.
So if one person transmits and three people get the packet, right? You have one transmission, you still get a multicast advantage in your model?
Actually, I do an overlay multicast. That means
each transmission
counts as one. In overlay multicast sense. although I mean the advantage of using overlay is that not you do not require the support of every router in this network. Only the group nodes needs to be cooperative. And this result, the second, the green, the blue line is the result of using the location guided Steiner tree algorithm, and it's very very close to the optimal result. And that means this algorithm is actually can achieve very very close to optimal performance. And the other two algorithms have higher cost, but they have lower computational complexity. So that this figure also shows the trade-off between performance and complexity in our algorithm design. I think I will jump. And this is the second topic, which we do a test set of laptops and PDAs, try to stream the audio traffic to this network using a peer-to-peer AirHub connection. We introduced a network manager to coordinate the access to the channel. And before you send out the packet, before you send out the flow, you have to contact the network manager to request a certain amount of bandwidth before you send out the packet. And this is a screen dump of sending out the audio traffic. And this corresponds to a portion of experiment where the two the sender and receiver are further away from each other, so that the channel quality is so dynamic, is so fluctuating. But here corresponds to a more stable channel condition where the sender and receiver are in the same room, and we have different levels of cross traffic to bring down the throughput of the from the sender to the receiver, and then the audio traffic will be adaptive. That means it will adapt its sampling rate to match the available bandwidth of the network. In the future, I'll focus on the network distribution systems, including ad hoc and sensor network, peer-to-peer wireless networking, and protocol design in wireless networks, especially in a non-cooperative environment. I also look at the economic issues of providing wireless services. And I will also validate my results using application and test that development. This is an ad hoc community network where the houses are connected with each other using peer-to-peer wireless connection. And one of the houses will become the internet gateway to the internet. And one potential application for this type of network is that you can have internet access. You can have community-based file sharing and neighborhood surveillance and so on. And even if this network is not something that you will use every day, it can also be good for disaster relief operations. For example, the base station in your house operates in a normal base station mode in a normal situation, but when disaster happens, your base station was switched. Your base station was switched into an AirHub mode where it can search the other base stations in your house and your community, which can form a mesh network automatically so that you will continue to have network access even in a disaster environment. And these are the interesting or challenging research problems. For example, automatic configuration for detection and self-healing, and you have to figure out how to provide incentive and cooperation. I also study some emerging applications in this network, such as neighborhood surveillance. This is a multi-hop Wi-Fi network. This group of nodes can reach the base station, and this can only reach the base station through this group of nodes. And there's a model of how can you model the market competition of all these packet forwarding in this network. And this can be used in a startup cafeteria so that people sitting in different areas will continue to have access to the base station. This is a peer-to-peer mobile network connecting the pedestrians and vehicles together on the highway or on the street. And it can be used to provide location-based services. And these are the interesting research problems I'd like to look at, including how to provide incentive and cooperation, what kind of location-based services can you provide in this network, and maybe some other emerging applications for this network. I think the convergence of wireless networking, pervasive computing, and ad hoc networking will become a promising area of research in this in next few years. And I'd like to study in this area, and especially proposing new applications and new paradigms, and test my my research through application building and test data experiments. And this concludes my talk. Danny. Oops. Is there any questions?